Today we are going to discuss feminist approach to the study of politics. This is a part of our first paper, Political Theory. So before beginning the discussion, I would like to mention the points which we will cover in our discussion. The first point which we will cover is the common features of feminist approach or the core themes which feminist approach would address. Second point is waves of feminism. There is a first wave, a second wave, as well as a third wave of feminism. The third point which we will cover is the types of feminism, and including all these three points, we will finish our topic. So before I begin the discussion, I would like to mention some statements and ask you to think that whether you agree with these statements or not, or whether these statements exist in the society or not. This is a sort of a brainstorming slide or a brainstorming session. Try to think whether these statements are agreeable or not. The first statement is that women are physically weaker than men. The second statement, men are mature and strong. Women are emotional, soft and caring. Try to think, try to match both these statements with each other and try to think that whether you agree with this or not. The third one is women cry, but men don't cry. Crying is considered as a very normal activity for women, but for men it is not considered as a normal activity. You try to think that whether this is agreeable or whether there is any scientific fact or explanation behind this type of statements or generalizations. Next one, women should take care of children and family. In society, there is a belief or there is a type of fact that exists that women, child bearing or child rearing, especially child rearing, is the responsibility of the women, more of the women, lesser of the men. Try to think whether there is any natural or biological fact behind this statement. Next, women cook, men earn. Cooking is considered a responsibility of the women and earning is considered a responsibility of the men. Whether it exists, this idea exists in the society or not, and whether you agree with this or not. Next, women must obey men. Men will rule. Women will be ruled. This idea, you think whether it exists or not. If it exists, try to question that why, what is the justification or what is the reason behind this. Next, women work, men are employed. Women and men both work, but women work is in many cases, it is unpaid. So it is not employment. When work is paid, it is employment. When work is unpaid, it is not considered as employment. So the part of the work that women do at home is mostly unpaid. So it is not employment. They work, but they're not employed. Last but not the least, women must be in the private sphere, men in the public sphere. The role and function of women are considered to be confined within the boundaries of the home or within the boundaries of the family, while men are supposed to be active in the public sphere. My point behind mentioning these statements is that you try to think that whether these ideas exist in the society, and if they exist, are we in a position to question these ideas? That is there any legal, social, political, or any other sort of justification, any natural or biological justification behind this type of ideas or these type of statements? Next, we will start with the topic of the feminist approach to politics. And while studying those things, we will try to relate with these ideas which exist in the society. Now, let us come to the next point. Here I have mentioned the names of some political scientists, philosophers or political thinkers which are very common to you all. You must have learned them in your school period or during learning other topics of political science. The names are Socrates, Plato, Aristotle, Machiavelli, Hobbes, Locke, Mill, Bentham, Kant, Rousseau, Marx, Lenin, Gramsci, Gandhi, Nozick, Rawls, Max Weber, David Easton, Charles Merriam, Gabriel Allibond, Harold Lasky. They are all political thinkers or political scientists. A few of them, I have mentioned only a few of them. And from the time period of the political thinkers, you can see that we have covered or we have included thinkers from almost 2,500 years back till political thinkers up to 20th century. But an interesting point to note here is that among all these popular political thinkers, not a single person is woman. So invariably the question which arises is that where have the women gone? Haven't women thought anything regarding politics during all those years, or their thinking were not recorded? What is the reason, or what may be the reason? Where have the women gone? Next, we can mention some names, and I would ask you to think, or I would ask you to consider the point that whether you have heard or whether you are well acquainted with these names. If yes, it's okay. If not, then why you haven't heard this name in spite of studying political science for a couple of years? These names are Begum Rokeya Shakhawat Hossain, Mary Carpenter, Sarala Devi Chaudhurani, Sarojini Naidu, Kadambini Ganguly, Pondita Ramabai, Muthulakshmi Reddy, Elizabeth Cady Stanton, Pankhurst sisters, etc. So try to think that if you have heard this name, it's okay. If you have not heard most of this name, then why you have not heard them? Has history been a bit insensitive to women who have contributed? Let us consider some new names. You have been studying political science, as I mentioned earlier, since last few years, but you are more acquainted with political thinkers who are male than with political thinkers who are female. Let us mention some names: Mary Wollstonecraft, Betty Friedan, Kate Millett, Simone de Beauvoir, Germaine Greer, Shulamit Firestone, Juliet Michel, Luz Irigaray, Naomi Wolf, Bell Hooks. Bell Hooks, as you can see, it is spelled in small letters as she wants it to be. Gayatri Chakraborty Spivak, Julia Kristeva, Judith Butler. Have you heard these names? If yes, it's okay. If not, then again the same questions. Why? Now let us come directly to the topic. So before beginning the topic, the parts of the topic or the points that we would like to cover, I would like to mention that feminism as a political term is not very old. It has basically come into political usage since the 20th century and became more popular in the field of politics since 1960s onwards. Before that, feminism was mostly used as a medical term, a term used in medical science, a term used in psychology or psychiatry. But from 20th century or from late 20th century, feminism became a very popular political concept. So popular and so diverse and so multiplied it has become that now we cannot say it is feminism. We have to say that it is feminisms. So that feminism in plural, because by feminism we now mean many things, not a single thing. So feminism is not a monolithic or homogeneous concept. It is marked with ambiguities, with complexities, with diversities, and with multi-layered ideas. So within this term, plurality of feminisms, now we have first wave of feminism, we have second wave of feminism, we have third wave of feminism. In terms of when the idea came, what it exactly wanted to say, like this. Apart from that, according to what exactly the argument of the thinkers are, according to that line, feminism can be divided into liberal feminism, radical feminism, socialist or Marxian feminism, black feminism, postmodern feminism. Even there is now a term called post-feminism. So we have come into an era where we are thinking beyond what feminist approach has said. But in spite of these multiple variations of the feminist approach, one point is there, that there is a common link between all arguments of all these above types of feminisms which I have mentioned just now. The common line of argument is that all of them agree on the point that women as a race are subjugated and subordinated since ages. And this position of subjugation and subordination should be changed. It should be altered for a better and transparent and just social order. So, in spite of all multiplicities and diversities, we can say that feminist approach has some core themes or some common features. And in this lecture, I would like to address those core themes or common features on which most of the variants of the feminist approach agree. So, the first common feature of this approach is a difference between sex and gender. Feminist approach always tries to make a distinction between sex and gender. Traditional political thought has always considered sex and gender as identical in terms of that, as because a man or a woman are biologically different from each other, so the social role they will be play is going to be according to their biological role, and the social role is also different from each other. According to that concept, sex is biological and gender is dependent upon that. Now, feminists try to contest this idea by mentioning that sex and gender are altogether different. Sex is biological. A person is born with certain physiological structures on the basis of which his or her sexual identity is defined. Even today, in 21st century, this biological idea behind sex has also come to be questioned, that whether a person can always be born with a clear sexual identity. That has also come under scanner since last several years. The next idea is that since it is biological, sexual division is natural. And since it is natural and biological, it is also considered to be immutable. Now, I have placed a question mark beside the term immutable to stress upon the point that sex was once considered, sexual identity was once considered immutable, but that is also questionable now, that whether the biological sexual identity with which a person is born is prone to change or not prone to change. In this age of gender reaffirmation surgery or conversion from male to female or female to male, we cannot say with conviction that a person's sexual identity is immutable or it cannot be changed. Now, what is the difference between gender and sex? Sex is biological, but gender is social, cultural, and it is man-made. It is a construct, a construction made by the society, by the culture. That means a person may be born as a boy or as a girl or as a man or as a woman, but with what sort of behavior he is going to do, what sort of role he or she is going to play in future, that is determined not by his or her biological identity, but by the society as well as the culture. It is the society and the culture that imbibes the idea of masculinity and femininity within human beings. From after birth, from a very young age, a boy is a boy is conditioned to be masculine and a girl child is conditioned to be feminine. As for example, in our home or in most of our families, usually we give innovative toys, cars, machineries to the boy to play with, and the girl child is given or gifted with utensils like toys and dolls, so that from a very young age we socialize them or we condition their mind to think that in future the boy child will grow to be an innovative person, a person maybe with a gun in his hand, with a car with him, And the girl is supposed to nurture family and help family, take care of family, maybe caregiver to the family in terms of cooking, etc. So gender is that by which we try to construct the idea of masculinity and femininity within human beings. Gender can be altered, it can be changed, it can be reconstructed, it can be deconstructed. I would like to mention here a point of Simone de Beauvoir, a comment made by Simone de Beauvoir, a very famous comment which defines the feminist approach, which is, one is not born but rather becomes a woman. That means a woman is not an identity with which I was born. I was what today a woman is meant by, that I have become, that I have been made by the society. Next point is, that is derived from the first point, that is biological determinism. Biology, in traditional political thought, there is an idea that anatomy is destiny. It means that I am born with a physiological structure, that is my anatomy, and because of the anatomy, my future life will be shaped in a particular way. That means my physiological structure or my anatomy is going to determine my destiny in future. So, according to this point, masculine and feminine behaviors are natural and they are dependent on a person's natural instincts. Feminist theory says that this idea of anatomy is destiny or biology is destiny, this idea is actually called biological determinism. And feminist approach contests this idea of biological determinism. It contests the idea that biology or anatomy is going to determine your future course of action. So, feminist approach questions biological determinism. It deconstructs the idea of biological determinism, mentioning or stressing on the point that biological determinism is actually a construct made by society to subjugate one race to the power and domination of another. The third point is patriarchy. Feminist approach, whatever may be its variants, always agreed on the point that society is patriarchal. Patriarchy or patriarchal means rule by men. And feminist approach thinks that patriarchy is the root cause of various other oppressions in the society. So until and unless we change patriarchal societal structure, we cannot be able to build a gender just society. Now, what is patriarchy? We have to understand very clearly that what is actually patriarchy. Here I would like to mention a very common and popular explanation made by feminist thinker Kate Millett. Kate Millett has defined patriarchy as a principle which operates through two modes, dual mode, or an idea that operates through two principles. One is rule of men over women, and second one is rule of older male over younger male. So rule of men over women. So women are conditioned, women are trained, women are made to learn by society that in future they will be ruled and men will rule. And another one, rule of older male over younger male. So when men are younger, they always see within the family, within the immediate society, that men are ruling. So they learn that I am now young, I am getting ruled by a man older than my age. So when I become older, I will become that ruling man, ruling other younger male as well as other younger as well as older female. So what is patriarchy? It is not merely a social system. Patriarchy is an ideology that permits our culture. Even women can be patriarchal. When women also support the rule by men or the domination by men, then also we can say that women are also having a mental setup that is patriarchal by nature. So patriarchy is much powerful than a rule. Patriarchy is actually an ideology. It rules our mind as well as our culture. Until and unless patriarchal societal structure can be changed, we cannot change the society to a gender just one. Next point, very important, is personal is political. Traditional political theory has always emphasized upon a divide between personal as well as political. Traditional political theory thinks that there is a clear-cut division of life between personal and political. Whatever happens within my family, or within the confines of my home are my personal problems. So that is a sphere which is separate from the political or the public sphere. The public sphere is that sphere which comprises of the government, the institution, the pressure groups, the political parties, and politics is a matter of the public life, not a matter of the private life. So traditional political theory is dependent upon the idea of public-private divide, considering politics to be an agenda of the public life, not an agenda of the private or personal life. Feminist approach to politics is basically a critical approach to politics which criticizes traditional political theory. Feminist approach thinks that this division or divide between public and private is questionable. It is divided by a line which is very much blurred. Politics cannot be divided into this public-private divide, because whatever is personal is also political. There is a gender division of labor, gendered division of power within our family and within the confines of our home. Just because it exists within our home, it is reflected in the broader society also. So whatever is personal is also political. Politics doesn't end at the threshold of my home. It is very much there within our home, within our personal relationships, within our intricate relationships. So we have to understand politics in its expanded version, not in its limited version of limiting it within the public sphere. So this assertion of personal is political was made by the famous feminist thinker Simone de Beauvoir in her book The Second Sex. So feminism contests the idea of public-private divide. Another point which is very important is equality and difference. As we have mentioned at the very earlier part of our discussion, that now we cannot say feminism as a singular term. We need to always mention the term in its plurality. So within this plurality, there is a division between equality and difference. There are certain sections of feminists who think that women should be equal to men. So whatever men can do, whatever qualities men have, women should also imbibe those qualities. Again, on the other hand, there are the difference point of view, feminists with the difference point of view who thinks that women are different from men and that difference is to be celebrated. So the difference feminists are those who argue for celebration of the difference. Not, they don't want to be equal with men, they want to celebrate the difference which women have from men. So, we have now covered the main tenets of feminist approach. Before finishing my discussion, my first phase of discussion on this approach, I would just like to make a brief summary of whatever we have studied till now. So, what are the main tenets of feminist approach? First, we have discussed the difference between sex and gender. Second, we have discussed the idea of patriarchy and the feminist approach special emphasis on the idea of patriarchy. Next, we have contested the idea of biological determinism and have seen how feminism contests, deconstructs and detests the idea of biological determinism. Next, we have contested the idea of public-private divide, emphasizing on the view that personal is political. Next, we have mentioned the thrust on equality and the thrust on difference, which different sections of feminist approach used to do. So with this, I would like to end the discussion of the core themes of feminist approach. Thank you.